Again, welcome. My name is Chris Sterzik, and I'm an applications engineer with Texas Instruments. I work specifically in their connected MCU department. In the CMCU organization, we provide a number of ARM-based microcontrollers with both wired and wireless connectivity solutions. Today I'm going to talk to you about enabling IoT predictive maintenance for motors with vibration analysis. So when we talk about the Internet of Things, one of the things I wanted to kind of talk about today is really the health of the motor. So how can we enable not just what the motor is doing, but actually the health of that motor and communicate that up to the cloud and give manufacturers, give users an ability to predictively actually maintain their equipment. And what's the benefit of that? So there are motors all around us. We see them in industry. We talk about manufacturing floors. We talk about pumps. We see them in residential and we see them in commercial areas. HVAC is a great example of that. Escalators, elevators is another example. And just to kind of give you an idea of the number of motors, electric motors that have shipped, we can kind of see here from IHS in 2017, 39.8, and predicting that number will grow in the coming years. In 2021, we talk about 41.5 million motors shipped. So with all these motors around you, what are some of the challenges? They kind of fall into three different buckets. We're talking about cost, we're talking about safety, and we're talking about the availability and reliability of these motors. So how does predictive maintenance address these three different areas? In the area of cost, we're talking about this kind of Goldilocks principle. Are you servicing the motor too soon or are you servicing the motor too late? If you service it too soon, you are essentially throwing away or you're replacing hardware that doesn't need to be replaced just yet. If you wait too long and you have the failure, now you have a catastrophic failure potentially on your manufacturing line, and there's an increased associated cost with dealing with that. In a similar vein, when we talk about safety, if you allow the motor to go to failure, you're now in an unknown state. So either personal safety or in terms of the manufacturing floor, the safety on the floor, if that motor fails, there poses a safety issue. And then finally, we talk about availability and reliability. This is kind of getting back to that same idea of cost. We want to be able to enable the manufacturers. We want to be able to enable the motor users to predictively engage. We want them to be able to plan. We want to be able to have them do their maintenance in such a way that it promotes availability and the reliability of the system. So what you don't want to have happen is you don't want to have your motor go down when you're in the middle of trying to perform a significant order. So when we talk about predictive maintenance, you need to monitor the condition of your motor. So what are some of the ways that we do that? Probably one of the most straightforward ways is temperature. You're looking for the temperature to increase of that particular motor. So if you can think of it, inside the motor you have bearings. When those bearings start to wear, you start to get more friction, and obviously the temperature increases. The point here being made as far as not being a primary indicator is that the bearing failure is what happens first, and the temperature increasing is a secondary effect. It happens afterwards. Another way of monitoring the motor is through current monitoring. So again, the motor represents a load. The amount of current being drawn by that motor is going to depend on the amount of work that it's doing. So again, in a similar type of vein, as the bearings start to fail, you're having to consume more power to do the same amount of work. As an interesting note for both the temperature and the conditioning monitoring, you can get, in a sense, false positives. If you can think very simply, if the for a pump application, if you are trying to move a particular liquid and that liquid is warm, it's going to obviously elevate the case temperature of your motor. Conversely, if that temperature or if that liquid is cold, certain liquids, the viscosity will actually change as you lower the temperature, and that will appear as an increased load when doing your current monitoring. A couple extra points, I guess, about current monitoring is just it does provide extra insight, so not just in the motor itself, but also the electronics that surround that motor. It gives you some, in the signature that you might see on the current, you might be able to tell where that issue is coming from. And then the other kind of negative or con against that is the expert installation. You do not want to inhibit or in any way interfere with the delivery of power to that motor. But that brings us really to what I want to talk about today, this idea of vibration monitoring. So we see this as being a primary indicator. Again, as the bearings start to fail, you can actually hear this idea of a shock pulse or a vibration. So there's a frequency that you can actually detect to tell you that that particular motor is failing. It does require an FFT, so you're getting into the frequency domain of analysis of the particular motor. So there's some additional engineering and mathematical training involved when evaluating that spectral content or the vibration of your particular motor. So what I want to kind of show here is, in a sense, the life of a motor. So this is talking about your potential interval failure. So the idea that over the course of your motor, when you first come off the factory floor or when you're first delivered with that motor, it's going to be in good, pristine condition. But then over time, you're going to see the effects of that wear and tear, and you see the condition of that motor go down. Ideally, what we want to be able to do is we want to increase where we see the potential failure and the time between when the actual failure occurs. So again, we think of, you know, at some point in the use of your motor, you're going to start to have effects of wear and tear. Certain point down the road, perhaps 6 months before the actual failure of the motor, if you had the ability to examine, let's say, for example, the lubricant, you could actually see particulates in the lubricant. That would be an indication of your motor is starting to fail. IR thermography, so again, this idea of temperature sensing, so you're starting to see the temperature of your system increase. This kind of gives you on the order of a 12-week, in a sense, lead time of predicting when your motor will fail. Hopefully not too many of you have experienced this with your vehicles, but you start to hear audible noises. You can tell just from your own personal senses that there's something wrong with the motor. And we go a little bit further along. Again, it's something you can physically touch. You can tell that your motor is heating up. And then finally, we have the point of failure. So the idea is when we talk about vibration, this is where it lands on this potential failure interval curve. So we give ourselves on the order of, you know, 9 to 10 months of predictive maintenance. So we kind of have a knowledge of, hey, this is when our motor is going to fail, and we can plan accordingly. So this idea, we can plan and schedule when we're going to perform that particular maintenance. So again, what's the advantages of the vibration monitoring? What I'm going to show here in the next couple of slides is really going to talk about how this is a non-invasive solution. This is something that's been very attractive, specifically for existing solutions, the idea that you can either magnetically or somehow mechanically externally bolt on to your motor housing and now, in a sense, retrofit your existing motors to do this type of vibration analysis. Again, the idea that it's non-invasive, we're not going to be interfering with any of the moving parts. And then lastly, because it's this idea of this retrofit, we can actually orient our sensors appropriately for a given gear or shaft orientation. So it gives lots of flexibility for these types of motor applications. As I already mentioned previously, it is a primary detection mechanism, so it's the idea that we can identify these failures early. And that leads us again to this idea of lower cost of maintenance, the idea that we can plan when our factory floors will have downtime. So kind of laying that groundwork for vibration, you know, what is needed for a vibration monitoring system? So there's going to be three major components I'm going to walk through: the sensor, the data acquisition piece, and then finally the communication. So how we're going to get this information up to the cloud, up to our operators, so they can make the right call for when the maintenance needs to be done. a couple different sensors here. We have our piezoelectric sensors and then our accelerometers. Typically, these are MEMS-based type of sensors. The things I just wanted to kind of highlight here is when we talk about piezoelectric, typically we're talking about some type of charge transfer mechanism. So there's going to be required to have some type of signal conditioning before that. So again, additional circuitry. This is kind of highlighted a little bit here when we talk about the MEMS piece of it. There's actually analog or even digital outputs. So you might see something, an accelerometer that has a SPI or an I2C type of interface. And then lastly, the idea that you can either have sensors that provide multi-axis. So again, the kind of harkening back to the previous slide, if you have the ability to measure multiple axes, you might have different components of the motor moving in particular directions, and you want to measure those different axes. The accelerometers lend themselves to this triaxial or multi-axial solutions. On the data acquisition side, so this is kind of where my CMCU background will come out a little bit. With the just improvements in technology and microcontrollers, we're seeing an ability to integrate both the analog to digital converter into the microcontroller. And the big part of this is at the silicon level, being really able to isolate the digital noise coming from that microcontroller and preventing it from impacting the A to D converter. And so this is why we're talking here about the effective number of bits and essentially your signal-to-noise ratio, because you're able to isolate or keep out the noise associated with the digital components. And then, again, kind of hand-in-hand, specifically with vibration monitoring, the analysis that we're doing here is in the spectral domain. So we need to have the horsepower to do the fast Fourier transforms and do that analysis. Interestingly, as you think about the increase in memory footprint size for various products, this really leans into this idea of machine learning algorithms. So today, we're looking at the site or at the edge, we're simply performing the FFT. We're doing the frequency analysis right there, but we're passing that on to the operator for them to decide, when does the maintenance need to take place. As those memory footprints grow, the idea is we could push that decision-making down into the edge itself. So again, the last piece of this is simply just the data transmission, wired versus wireless communications. For what we're talking about, and this is again getting back to this idea of the retrofit idea, when you have a manufacturing floor, typically those customers don't want to lay power and they don't want to lay wired connectivity. So it really lends itself to these wireless type of solutions. So again, a vibration monitoring system solution, what are we going to look at? We're going to talk about the hardware and the software components that make up this solution, the sensor piece of it that scales with the requirements. So we're talking about the sensitivity and basically the range of the measurement, so the number of gravities, but the range of that. Ultra low power, again, we want to be able this to be remotely located. We want to be able to retrofit in factory floors easily, so we want to provide a battery solution. The performance of the MCU, again, we want to be able to do the fast Fourier transform in addition to making some decision logic there, and then finally the IoT compatibility. On the software side of thing, again, we need to have software that complements the hardware in terms of power, so we want to have power management components, scalability, and industrial protocols. So we want to be able to support things like your wireless heart, type of stacks so that they can, so these industrial and automated building automation customers can easily integrate this particular solution. So from a hardware perspective, this is actually a TI reference design. This TIDA number here is how, if you were to go to the TI.com website, you could reference it. Again, it's kind of three components, if you will. There's the sensor component. This is using a Kionix three-axis accelerometer. We have an anti-aliasing filter here, as well as some additional filtering to provide for the source impedance of the ADC. And then finally, we have just some very simple power management components associated with the sensor. This is all based around this MSP432 product. So within Texas Instruments, we provide what's called our launch pad ecosystem. What you'll have is you'll have a launch pad type of device with a given processor, and then we provide what are called booster packs, and these will plug into that particular launch pad. So that's kind of the ecosystem here. And again, just a couple comments about this particular device is, again, the ADC, the precision ADC. When we talk about the M4F, the F is that floating point piece. And then finally, we have the scalability in terms of memory sizes. So again, kind of thinking in the future of what kind of decision logic, what kind of basically, how can we increase the application at the node? And then finally, the last piece of it, again, part of this booster pack methodology is we have the ability now to, you know, connect various wireless connectivity solutions. So if you were to go right now to the website, you would find the example now is actually using this BLE booster pack to provide the connectivity. But it kind of showing here that in the background there are other booster packs, there's other pieces of hardware available. And that actually complements our software stack. So when we talk about the SimpleLink, the software development kit, there are several pieces associated with this. These solutions are based on a POSIX layer, so this is giving you the flexibility to move between different operating systems, whether you're free or TI-RTOS. We talk about the wireless stacks, the stacks here for the Bluetooth and the sensor actuator, and then the TI driver specific for the MSP432. And then finally, when we start talking about our network services, and then also our IoT plugins for the different vendors that are out there. So the gentleman before me talking about, you know, your Amazon Web Services, your Microsoft Azure, and then the IBM Watson. So these are plugins that are made available through the software development kit. So in summary, you know, vibration monitoring is predictive. We want to, you know, provide customers with a solution that they can address their motor issues in a predictive sense, in the idea of providing them value with their production lines. We want to see them increase their productivity, specifically, you know, using this idea of predictive maintenance to address and to really plan when they're going to have downtime. As far as what's next, I've kind of alluded to this before, is the idea that, you know, we have this processing capability within the MSP432. We would like to really see, you know, instead of passing this information up to the operators through the cloud, but actually utilizing the cloud to really move some of that information or move that decision-making technology back into the edge nodes. And then finally, just really leveraging the cloud to provide a more succinct or even more improved idea of predictive maintenance so that we can, in a sense, maximize the life and the utilization of these motors. All right, well, thank you very much. Is there any questions that I can answer? Yeah, and that's, yeah, so we've definitely focused on motors here, but there's lots of other applications, kind of peripheral applications this could be expanded to. So the question was, could this be expanded to vibration of transformers? Could you actually measure the vibration of something else other than just a motor? And the answer is obviously yes. Again, thank you.